In this video, we want to talk about addition of constraint, which is again a subtopic in post-optimality analysis. And suppose we want to add a constraint in a given LPP. So why would we be doing this addition of a constraint in an LPP? Let's say we already have an LPP where we want to optimize some function and we already have subject to certain constraint and the non-negative restrictions. And here, the size of the coefficient matrix is, suppose if it is m cross n, there are m number of constraint and n number of decision variable. So from here, and knowing that the rank of A is m, we can choose a basis matrix. We choose a basis matrix, which is usually denoted by B, of m cross m matrix. So this basis matrix is a square matrix of order m because there are m number of constraint. And now if we want to add a constraint, in this current LPP and we want to understand the change which happened due to this addition of a constraint. So the size of the matrix is actually is now m plus 1 cross n. So this means probably that the size of the basis will be changed. So yes, the size of the basis will get changed. Now let's see how do we handle this change and why in a problem will arise something like this. So again, we can have the practical situation something like that, that there is a company which manufactures something whether they want to understand the profit, or there is a company which is dealing with certain costs, so they want to minimize the cost of that particular decision variables. So we take, let's say you have two or three decision variables and they follow certain restrictions or constraint while formulating this LPP. So we have some constraints also here and we have on the right hand side certain resources. So maybe this is the constraint for the first department. Constraint of first department. And then similarly, we can have the constraint of other departments. But then in addition to individual department, now there is a constraint of quality check department. So each product that has been actually now the company is producing or they are earning the profit due to that, they have to go through the quality check department also. So there would be again another one constraint. So I may take, let's say if it is AM plus 1th constraint. So we can take it like this and so on, plus AM plus 1th constraint. And then we take, let's say third, because we have only taken the three variables. So X3, and then we may have either less than or it may be greater than or equal to some constraint here, availability of the time of the quality check department. So this right hand side may be anything which actually depict the time or the constraint based on the quality check department. Now how to incorporate this change in the optimal solution of the previous problem? So this is about the addition of a constraint in the given LPP. We already have the solution of the star problem, but how to handle this addition of a constraint? Now let's look this in a problem which we have written here. Now we already consider a problem here and this is a maximization problem where we have four decision variables. So this is the LPP and corresponding to this LPP, we have the optimal table. So this LPP is usually solved as we apply simplex method. And now we want to understand. So the question is, what is the effect of addition of a constraint which is 2x1 plus 3x2 plus x3 greater than or equal to 4. So suppose we want to add now this constraint to this given LPP. So what will be the effect here? Here we I have not taken the decision variable x4. That automatically means that this constraint is actually like 2x1 plus 3x2 plus x3 plus 0 times x4. And then we have greater than or equal to 4. So that's the constraint that we want to add in this LPP. Now the very first thing that we want to check is, so the first step that we need to do is check the optimal solution in this constraint. So here the optimal solution x1 is 16 by 19. And because x2 is not appearing here, it's a non-basic variable. x3 is a non-basic variable, which is 0. And x4, which is 5 by 19. So now check these value in the given constraint. So check whether the constraint is satisfied with the current optimal solution or not. If it is satisfied, then we say that this constraint is already a part of the feasible region and this will not contribute anything separately adding in the LPP. But if it does not satisfy, that means we have not considered the whole feasible region and it will affect somehow the optimal solution of the given LPP. Now let's see this. So we want to satisfy 2 times x1. So x1 is 16 by 19 and then plus 3 times x2. So, but x2 is 0, so we can simply take 0. x3 is also 0, so this is 0 plus 0 times x4. Now, whatever be x4, it is multiplied by 0, so this quantity is 0. Now, this whole quantity should be greater than or equal to 4. And on this left-hand side, we say this quantity is actually, I can write it here, 32 by 19. And this quantity is greater than or equal to 4. No, this quantity is not greater than or equal to 4, so this does not satisfy. So, if it does not satisfy, then we need to add. So we see here. So we can note this. Note if constraint satisfy the given solution, there is no need to add it further. If it does not satisfy, then move to step 2. So here I am moving to step number 2. And since it is not satisfying, so I need to now add this constraint into the LPP. And also now we see here that there are 3 constraints. So in the given LPP, there are 3 constraints. So that is why there are 3 basic variables in the optimal simplex table. And now because we have added another one constraint, so this means there would be 4 constraints. So the size of this basic variables must be 4. So what we do is, now we want to add this constraint directly in this table. And let's see how you can add this into this table. So what we do is we simply write these coefficients in this objective table. And let's see how we write here. So we have this basic variable. Now I'm writing all the decision variables which are already there in the original LPP. But we also introduce one variable due to this constraint. Due to this constraint, and here there is a surplus variable involved because it is greater than. So if it is greater than, even if it is a surplus, I am just calling this as S4. And on this side, we write all decision variables which were already there in the table. So this is previous basic variable. In addition to that, now I also add S4. So we always start with a slack or surplus variable, whichever it is arriving. And we always introduce an inequality constraint. I'll come back what happens if there is an equality constraint that we need to add. Because in equality constraint, we don't have a slack and surplus variable. But for the moment, I'm considering that the addition of the constraint and whatever constraint we are adding, that constraint has inequality in it, not the equality. So S4 is appearing here. And now let's write all the table here. Let's write all this. This table is all the one that we already know, which is already given to us. So there is no change here. So this is half 0, 29 by 38, 53 by 38. So this is all my previous data that I'm writing. Okay, so here is the table filled from the last optimal table that we have obtained while solving the original problem. So once we fill this table, now what I need to do is I only need to now write the last row, which is due to the addition of the constraint. And when we write this row, so here in this row, we directly write coefficients from the new constraint that has to be added. That has to be added. Which has to be added? Now we write, we see here, we have 2x1 plus 3x2 plus xc. So the coefficient of x1, I am simply writing coefficient of x1 in the column of x1, the coefficient of x2 as 3, the coefficient of s3 as 1. Now x4 is not appearing in this constraint, so that means it is 0. Obviously, coefficient of s1, s2, s3 are also not appearing. So here they are also 0. But s4, of course, when we change this constraint inequality, there is the coefficient of s4 is 1, and the right hand side, this is 4. Now once we introduce this row here in this simplex table, so because we are directly adding this row, this must have disturbed some optimality, and we can see that what optimality conditions or the simplex table conditions it has disturbed. We see here that x1 is a basic variable. This is a basic variable. So this must correspond to a ready identity column. We see here we have 0. We have 1 here. We have 0. We have 0. And here also it should be 0. But it is now 2. Each basic variable correspond to an identity column. So this identity column, the first, the column which is written here in x1, this has disturbed. Also x4 is a basic variable. Also x4, this is a basic variable. This is fine. So here it is not disturbed. We see here this is 0, 0, 1, 0, 0. This is not disturbed. The third basic variable is S3. We see here also this is 0, 0, 0, 1, and then we get 0. This is also not disturbed. And the last basic variable is S4, and which is also fine. So what has been disturbed is only X1. So first we need to maintain this as the identity column, and then we'll start looking the optimality and the feasibility condition of this table. Because we have introduced this in the table, so this disturbance is expected. Now how to handle this disturbance? We'll introduce the row operation. So to do that, let's consider this as first row R1, R2, R3, R4, and we have the fifth row. So my fifth row is now should be changed to R5 minus. Now I want to make here 0 because I want to maintain this column as the identity column, so that the simplest, this whole table can be considered as a simplex table, and we can start doing the simplex iteration. This 2 has to become 0 with the help of this one. So there is only one entry in this. So R5 minus 2 times R2. With this row operation, maintain the identity column of basic variables. Okay, rest are already not disturbed, only this one is disturbed. So we are maintaining this column. And also what I have written here is, this is because it is greater than. What I have missed here is, because it was greater than, so here this quantity is a negative sign. Just please excuse me, this quantity, because it was a surplus, so this quantity is minus 1. So this means S4 is also disturbed. Now to handle this S4, what we need to do is we simply multiply this constraint by a minus sign, so that become minus 2, minus 3, minus 1. This become plus 1 and this become minus 4. So in that case, the row operation actually becomes plus 2 times R4. So with this row operation, now we start the calculation again. So this quantity now again x1, x4, s3, and here we have s4. Remember, in this step, no entering variable is there. No entering variable, because we are only maintaining the basic structure of simplex table. So this is this 169 by 38, 1 by 2, 0, 29 by 38, and all the entries will remain same. So, but when you apply this row operation, when we apply this R5, what we see here is we get this last quantity as this minus 44 by 19. And this is same except in the last row, because the last row we have changed 0, 0. This is 10 by 38 minus 2 by 38, 0, 1. This is same as above. So first three columns are same as above. Now from here, it is very easy to conclude. We see here the ZJ minus CJ are all greater than or equal to 0. And this problem was for maximization, so the optimality has arisen, but the feasibility has disturbed. So if the feasibility is disturbed, we know which method we can apply. We can apply the dual simplex method. So here we apply dual simplex method, because dual simplex method works when the current solution is optimal, but it is not feasible. So in this case, when we have an addition of a variable and it disturbs the feasibility, so we can eliminate this vector, most negative, and we want to enter by taking the minimum ratio rule with the scalar. So here the scalars are minus 48 and by 19, this is negative, and minus 2 by 38. So by appropriate dual simplex entering criteria, we see here 169 by 38 will be the entering variable. That means x2 will come into the basis and s4 will leave, and this element will become the pivot element. So for more clarity on dual simplex method, I suggest people to look dual simplex method video on this, and from here onwards we can apply dual simplex method to get the optimal value. Now let's take another remark. What happens if we have an equality constraint? Suppose we want to add an equality constraint. Of this type, 2x1 plus 3x2 plus 7x3 plus x4 and maybe less than or equal to 8. Sorry, because we want to take equality, so let me to take this constraint as equality. Now, whenever we have an equality constraint, we must write this into two parts. 2x1 plus 3x2 plus 7x3 plus x4 less than or equal to 8. And we can have 2x1 plus 3x2 plus 7x3 plus x4 greater than or equal to 8. So, either this is satisfied with optimal solution, or this is satisfied with the optimal solution, because we are talking about the half spaces. So when we say it is less than or equal to 8 and here we say it is greater than or equal to 8, one of the constraint among these two must be satisfied by the given solution. So whichever constraint is satisfied by the given solution, so for example, let me to call this as 1 and 2. For example, if 1 satisfies the given optimal solution, then introduce 2 as addition of a constraint. In LPP, so we want to introduce the another constraint which is not satisfied. So as I have already said, if this constraint is satisfying the optimal solution, we do not need to add it. Actually becomes a redundant constraint. But if it does not satisfy the optimal solution, so we need to introduce that. We can introduce directly slack or surplus variable. check the column which maintains the feasibility, which maintains these basic columns, and accordingly you may need to apply dual simplex method because it most oftenly disturbs the feasibility. If in any case it disturbs the optimality, it will not certainly disturb the optimality.